top of having talent and looks and all those other things, it's necessary to have character. You can't do it any other way. You've got to have self-control, and you've got to be able to put your life into two greatest stars, I think, the two most utterly talented stars that ever were in the picture business didn't make it.
Enormously successful in silent films, neither John Gilbert nor Clara Bow survived in sound.
Clara Bow was so filled with excitement and fun and romance and sex. And she wanted to prove to the world that she was this, and she just gave of herself.
Louise Brooks, a contemporary of Clara Bow, worked for the same studio and experienced similar star treatment.
I thought she was the most marvelous star of the 20s because she was the 20s, really. Garbo came from Europe, and Swanson was already very sophisticated, dressy, and Cecil B. DeMille, but Clara was, as she called herself, the real jazz baby. Got her job in Hollywood, not, she said very carefully, through a beauty contest. She never thought she was beautiful. It was a personality contest that she won.
Clara Bow belonged to the first generation to be raised on the movies. A great ambition began to unfold in me, she said. It was ridiculous, but I knew I wanted to be a motion picture actress. She won the personality contest despite the photograph she submitted. They made another one. She said she was 16. She was actually 14.
Adela Rogers St. John did a wonderful series at that time in photoplay and told about how she grew up, her father, in Brooklyn, on the streets.
Clara's family was extremely poor. Her mother had bouts of mental illness and on one occasion tried to kill her. Regarded as the worst-looking kid on the street, Clara was a tomboy, accepted by the local gangs. I could lick any boy my size, she said, and proved it in her first role. In the film, Clara played a stowaway. It was the last time anyone would mistake her for a boy.
Thank you.
said Variety. Clara Bow lingers in the eye long after the picture has gone. B.P. Schulberg, an independent producer, put her under contract at $50 a week and exploited her in film after film. They were cheaply made, and sometimes Clara made three at once. But they gave her the experience she could never have acquired elsewhere. In 1924, together with 12 other girls, she was voted a Wampus Baby Star by motion picture advertisers. An almost unrecognizable Clara is the girl on the left. When she made The Plastic Age with Donald Keith, Schulberg promoted her as the hottest jazz baby in films. She was 18. She'd already made 23 films. Clara went with B.P. Schulberg to Paramount Pictures, where she was given a supporting role.
She was absolutely a sensation in the United States in Dancing Mothers. And she was so, she just swept the country. I know I saw her and I thought she was, wonderful. Everybody did. She became absolutely a star overnight with nobody's help.
She got help, of a sort, from Eleanor Glynn, who announced that Clara had a quality known as it. Schulberg immediately cast her in a film written by Madame Glynn, who gave it her seal of approval with a personal appearance.
There was a tremendous discussion about exactly what was it. And somebody said, it is sex appeal. And Madame Glynn said, well, it's partly sex, and it's partly this, it's partly that, it's partly something else. Anyway, she declared that the it girl was Clara Bow. Clara Bow was the personification of it.
Clarence Badger was the director of It, and he was the first to pay tribute to Clara's quality as a screen performer. She would melt into the character she was portraying so cleverly, he said, just as though it was the story of her own life. The camera seemed to cause her and her ideas to blossom.
He said that she was absolutely marvelous. You set up, you told her what the scene was, and you just let her go. He said, for instance, where she has a little toy dog. Well, he didn't tell her. Remember, she looks at the dog, and she turns around and lifts up his tail and looks at the eye. That was her idea. Everything she did was completely original, and he said, when you start to direct her, you get mad, because she's doing all these things, and then you run them, and they're wonderful. Another thing she did in that picture, well, the scene where she goes in to interview him. Remember, she walks across and slides right straight across the desk. All those things were hers, you see. That was what made her so marvelous.
Clara Bow came from the same background as most of her fans, and they could easily identify with her and the way she behaved.
Clara Bow invited us all to dinner, and that was the first time that any of us had ever been out to dinner in a group. And Clara, who didn't know which fork was up, had this charming dinner, and when I could remember, I can see it. We pushed the plates back in the middle of the table and left them there. While the dessert came on, never occurred to us to tell somebody to take it back in the kitchen.
Her unpredictability, so endearing on the screen, caused problems for her when she tried to join Hollywood society.
She wasn't acceptable socially. Eddie Sutherland my husband gave absolutely the best parties in Hollywood. So I asked him one day to invite Clara Bow, and he said, oh, heavens, no, we can't have her. We don't know what she'd do. She's from Brooklyn. Everyone on the lot at Paramount said, of course, she's the greatest actress, but she wasn't acceptable, and she knew that.
In Man Trap, Clara played a city girl who impulsively marries a Canadian trapper, Ernest Torrance. A visitor from the city, Percy Marmont, unsettles the marriage.
Something sort of a little bit of the primitive about her, which I think was what everybody liked about her. She was uninhibited. She was not constricted in any way like some of the others were.
The director of Man Trap, Victor Fleming, was having an affair with Clara. The press hinted that others were too. Clara advanced the careers of several of her friends, among them Gary Cooper. The newspaper stories endangered Clara's career because her contract, like so many others, included a morality clause. This scene was typical of the double standards of Hollywood under the Hayes office. Teasing the audience was acceptable. But Hollywood didn't approve of stars who practiced what they played. The press campaign intensified.
You need a strain of stone or ice or something in you to be able to handle all that happens to a movie star, and she didn't have it.
She was very fond of gambling, terribly fond of gambling. So the studio got her terribly in debt to them. Because she didn't understand money, of course. And she would lose 10, 15, 20,000 a lick at these gambling casinos in Nevada.
The studio advanced her more and more money. Clara got deeper and deeper into debt. On top of all this, sound arrived. Clara was terrified of talkies. Louise Brooks, also having problems at Paramount, was ordered to join her for a voice test.
So I wasn't told Clara was going to make the test with me. And I'd never met her. And I walked in to the studio, and there was a big couch. And she was sitting in a corner of it, all curled up. And I sat down, and she just began to talk. She knew all about me. She was telling me about how dreadfully Schulberg was treating her. And I said, well, what's he doing? She says, Schulberg sends Ruth Chatterton up to my house on Thursday.
Ruth Chatterton, a Broadway star, had been told to improve Clara's voice. Clara didn't want improving.
And she said, I beat it out the back door because they make me feel so terrible that I can't talk.
Clara felt her background was more exposed than ever.
Oh, please, ma'am, won't you sit down and listen?
I can listen standing up. I do it with my ears, you know.
And he told her her Brooklyn accent was awful, but it really wasn't at all.
Sure. They'll make you think they believe in them while they're playing you for a poor fish.
One of her first talkies was a remake of a Louise Brooks silent, Love 'em and Leave 'em.
But you can't put anything over on me anymore. From now on, it's Love 'em and Leave 'em. That's me.
Clara's troubles worsened. Her former secretary and closest friend, Daisy DeVoe, was charged with stealing from her. DeVoe got a year in jail. The trial was the most sensational since Arbuckle's, for all the intimate details of Clara's private life came into the open. Drink, gambling, sex. Clara Bow Pictures plummeted at the box office. Paramount canceled her contract. In 1931, she married Rex Bell and retired to his ranch. You spend all your youth, she said, all your energy to attain the thing you wanted more than anything else in the world, and when you get it, you find you don't want it.
She was the biggest star. She was the biggest moneymaker in Hollywood, above Garbo, above them all. But as soon as Schulberg lost interest in her, that, of course, is when she began to slip inside her own head. Because Clara really didn't exist. She didn't exist off the screen. She'd manufactured this whole person.
Body is made of a
okay, okay, Jerry, don't go away, folks. Don't go away. As Shakespeare said, you ain't seen nothing yet. This is absolutely the biggest attraction on the Midway.
Clara made a comeback at Fox. It failed. I've had enough, she said. A sex symbol is a heavy load to carry when you're tired, hurt, and bewildered.
And when she dances, folks, she makes old men lose their canes and cripples throw away their crutches. She's red hot, folks, red hot in a dance that is instructive, up to date, and educational. Think of it, folks, the biggest attraction on the Midway. For one quarter, 20 minutes, that's the most fun of another. You can't afford to miss it.
It was Clara Bow's last screen appearance. She was 26 years old. One of the great love stories of the 20s, Greta Garbo and John Gilbert. Looking at these pictures today, every eye is on Garbo. But in 1926, Gilbert was the greater star.
He was the greatest romantic star. He was the highest paid actor in Hollywood. He had just signed a contract for $1.5 million, which, you know, no one had ever signed a contract like that before. Anything that he wanted, it sort of he touched, was glorious. He had a fantastic following. And almost in the twinkling of an eye, it was gone.
John Gilbert's career was at its height for only 4 years. In that time, he inherited Valentino's mantle, the great lover. In The Merry Widow, directed by Erich von Stroheim, his co-star was Mae Murray. Their waltz was intended to be as compelling as Valentino's tango. Widow made John Gilbert a star of the first magnitude, yet he'd already spent 10 years in pictures. In one of the MGM films he helped to write, Gilbert included memories of his childhood.
Jack had had a tragic childhood. His mother had not wanted him, his mother paid no attention to him, his mother was an actress, a provincial actress. He hardly ever went to school. He dragged through schools. It would be 2 weeks here, 3 weeks there. He never had toys. He was never allowed to carry toys or books with him because it was too much trouble traveling from one theater to another. She would lock him in closets for hours, all day, just to get him out of the way. She had many lovers, and she would wake him up in the middle of the night to introduce him to his new daddy.
God pity the theatrical child, said Gilbert. He doesn't belong. He's a pariah among other children with homes and backyards. He doesn't know the meaning of the word home. Gilbert entered pictures in 1915, riding horses for westerns at Innsville, Thomas Ince's studio at Santa Monica. He was soon playing leads. First time, he said, I felt I belonged.
Jack Gilbert. I don't know whether to talk from my head or my heart. They both don't agree. Well, we met when he was a young, struggling actor, and I liked him very, very much. He was very courteous, and he was very helpful sometimes in the scenes with me, you know, advising me in a nice way what to do.
Gilbert's ambition was to direct, but he was in demand only as an actor. He spent 2.5 years with Fox, and in 1924, he joined Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. Louis B. Mayer ran the studio, and in charge of production was Irving Thalberg, who quickly became a close friend to Gilbert and ensured that he settled in with the other MGM contract players. Gilbert's first role for MGM was a story written by Eleanor Glynn, His Hour. To his amazement, he was a huge success. Glynn thought him greater than Valentino. Gilbert felt the success belonged to his director, King Vidor, who, for his next film, required a different kind of actor.
Gilbert was this intensive, romantic leading man, and we were going for the ordinary soldier, you know, just the average guy. I wasn't terribly against him, but I did change his image. And I dated his fingernails and cut him short and changed his clothes and changed his appearance. And of course, he did a wonderful performance in it. And the romantic lover helped, because there are a lot of love scenes, and much of the story is his love story with a French girl.
Of the famous chewing gum scene, Gilbert said only a suggestion was offered in the script, and no one really knew what would happen.
I was stalling for an idea. And somebody was chewing gum. I thought, that's right. See, the French girls didn't chew gum.
Thank you. parade lifted Gilbert's popularity to even greater heights.
Jack was coming east for the opening night, and we were divorced then. And he just had high hopes that maybe I would go to the opening with him. It was a beautiful night, and it was the beginning of his great success, of course. So I'm very happy for him. He had this great big photograph of himself on my dressing table at the Algonquin. And modesty should prevent my saying it, but I have no modesty, so I'm going to say it. To my beloved wife, after whom God patted the angels. It was emotion, but I'm a little ham at heart, and I loved it. I wouldn't have changed a word.
Garbo arrived in Hollywood in September 1925. As a teenager in Stockholm, she had played in advertising films. Clothes, pastries. She attended drama school and became the protege of the great director Moritz Stiller. Stiller brought her to America, but was not permitted to direct her first film for MGM. This rare scene shows her arrival on the first day of production. Garbo was cast in a vamp role. She thought it ridiculous. Nor was she happy with the choice of leading man Ricardo Cortez. Her second film was started by Stiller, but he was dismissed. This made Garbo even more insecure. She wanted to go home to Sweden. She refused a role in support of John Gilbert, now MGM's top star. His director, Clarence Brown.
I had already started the picture, and we were trying to get a woman to play opposite John Gilbert in the picture. And we were up at Arrowhead on our first locations. And when I got back, the studio gave us the okay to go ahead. It was all right to go ahead with Garbo. And it just happened that the scenes we started shooting when we got back were the scenes in which Garbo was introduced to Gilbert at the railroad station. And that's from then on, that was the development of their love affair in the picture. Just had a real love affair going for me that you couldn't beat any way you tried.
Said all those awful trite things that we don't say anymore. Where have you been all my life? And you are the only man in the world, and you are everything. And she made you believe that it had happened to her. They were really two people utterly and totally in love.
In a rare interview, Garbo said, John Gilbert is one of the finest men I have ever met. He is so fine an artist that he lifts me up and carries me on with him. It is not just scenes that I am doing, I am living.
There was an explosion. I have never seen two people so violently, excitedly in love. I mean, when she walked through a door, if he was in the room, he went white and took a great long breath and then walked toward her as though he were being yanked by a magnet or something. And she had always been rather aloof, and that I want to go home now line stuck around her. And she just adored him. It was, and when they made love scenes together for a movie, as they did in a number of them, they had sometimes to be censored a little bit. They were so violently in love that they couldn't conceal it.
She was man, woman, and child. You can't pigeonhole Garbo. She was fascinating, extremely selfish, beautiful, strange. She'd walk around Jack Gilbert's garden perfectly nude with a dressing gown over her back like this. And the Japanese gardener would look at her. But she was completely unconscious, being Swede.
She wanted to give up pictures. And she said, I will marry you at once and leave the screen. And Gilbert didn't want her to leave the screen. And she said, you're not in love with me. You're in love with Garbo.
But when Eleanor Boardman married King Vidor, Gilbert impulsively suggested a double wedding. Garbo agreed. Gilbert waited in vain.
And it got to be the point I was upstairs with a little champagne, the people were downstairs, the music was playing, Garbo hadn't shown up, and Gilbert was getting very nervous. He's getting rather violent. Seems that the mayor was at one of the guests, was in the men's room with Gilbert, and Gilbert was crying about this thing, the situation, what was going to happen. He was very nervous, and Mayer said, sleep with her, don't marry her. Gilbert socked him and knocked him down. He hit his head on the tile. That was really the beginning of the end of Gilbert's career.
Beginning with that point, after Jack had knocked him down, drawn blood in the bathroom and the whole thing, and he said, I'll destroy you. From that point on, you can see Jack's career going like this, that he's pulling in one direction, and there's some absolute force pulling him back.
When Thalberg fell ill, Mayer was left for a while in charge of production. He put Gilbert in two surprisingly cheap pictures.
And at that time, Gilbert suggested doing The Widow in the By Street, which was a poem which was very popular in England. And Gilbert tried to tell the story to Mayer in Mayer's office. Well, it happened to be a story that didn't strike Louis B. Mayer very well, because both the girl and the boy's mother had various colorings that did not quite appeal to Louis B. Mayer, and at one point he finally stopped and said, are you telling me that this woman in this book is a whore? And Gilbert said, what's wrong with that? My mother was a whore. Whereupon Mayer's temper flashed, his fists went along with it, and he floored Gilbert with one blow.
Gilbert seemed to have lost Garbo too. The affair had cooled, but she remained in his house, a rather distant friend. Now Gilbert fell for another luminous actress, Jean Eagles. In this newspaper story, Gilbert played an awkward young reporter. He escorts the glamorous society editor to a ball. The beginning of an affair which ends with his ruin. Thalberg had encouraged Gilbert to work on the script with director Montabell. They turned it into an American version of The Widow in the By Street, the story Mayer had refused to allow Gilbert to make. Gilbert, the press suggested, was loving the screen's two most beautiful actresses at the same time. Meanwhile, Garbo, playing Anna Karenina, fell ill. She was unhappy with her leading man and her director. MGM replaced them. The fans wanted to see Garbo and Gilbert together again. MGM changed the title to Love. Garbo insisted that only Gilbert could direct her in the love scenes.
She hung on his every word, that she would look at him before any shot was made. If he didn't approve, it would be reshot.
Gilbert directed nearly half the picture, with the agreement of the credited director, Edmund Goulding. Gilbert directed the farewell between Vronsky and Anna. Vronsky imagines he is going away with his regiment, a brief parting. Anna knows she has lost him forever and intends to commit suicide. For his sake, she makes light of the situation. Nicholas Skenk, the new president of MGM's parent company, now conspired with William Fox to oust Louis B. Mayer and merge the two companies. Fox wanted Gilbert as part of the deal. Gilbert signed an extraordinary contract for $1.5 million.
It was the first of its kind. Nobody earned money like this, you know. And he was... There was a clause that he felt was a built-in protection so that Mayer couldn't get at him. The clause is there that he was under contract to Skenk, and his pictures are to be supervised by Irving Thalberg.
The MGM Lion records its roar for the talkies. The company had held out against sound as long as it could. Eventually, it gave in and put all its stars, except Garbo, on display in a lavish review. Gilbert appeared with Norma Shearer, Thalberg's wife. Thalberg chose Shakespeare for their talkie debut.
Oh, gentle Romeo, if thou dost love, pronounce it faithfully. What if thou think'st I am too quickly won? I'll frown and be perverse and say thee nay.
Lady, by yonder blessed moon, I swear, which tips with silver all these fruit tree tops.
Swear not by the moon, the inconstant moon, that monthly changes in her circle orb. Blessed thy love be likewise, fairy moon.
Come! Very good. Print the last one.
How was it, Lionel?
Very good, Jack. Remarkable. Really, I was surprised.
What?
I don't mean I was surprised. That sounds silly, but you know. I mean, it was really.
Yeah. One or two critics thought Gilbert's voice affected. Most of the others approved.
No kidding.
But this short scene mattered little. What did matter was Gilbert's performance in his first feature-length talkie, His Glorious Night. Gilbert had gone on honeymoon with a new wife, Ina Clare. He returned to learn that audiences had greeted his performance with derision.
That thought you'd never come.
The window's open above.
But you know that I've been there for 2 hours, waiting, waiting, waiting.
I couldn't come before.
But you could have sent some word. No, darling, dearest one, what have I done but wait, wait ever since I've known you?
It was an image just as valid of the great lover, the intensive lover. And Valentino had the same image, and I think he would have suffered the same death had he lived.
You can't, you won't. You wouldn't be so cruel, knowing how much I want you.
You couldn't put this image that he had established into words. It becomes funny.
Your eyes told me so, your heart told me so, your lips told me so.
The people were waiting for what was he saying all the time? In the silent films, they're waiting, and then they hear these words and they laugh.
I love you. I've told you that 100 times this week. I love you.
And I told you not to tell me that again. I don't wish to hear it.
But what is a man to do, darling, when he loves so helplessly as I?
Gilbert was not the only victim. Charles Farrell, Edmund Lowe, Mary Pickford were laughed at and even booed in some theaters. One rumor about Gilbert's voice gathered immediate strength.
The producers, the executives, said his voice was high. They must have dreamt this up in one of their meetings, but his voice was not high. He had a good, normal speaking voice, a very good speaking voice. It was not high.
Savior, we can't have people going around saying that...
The truth about me. Oh, Lisa, I want to be good. I want to be good. I know it's not a new thing for me to say, but this time I am through.
Before His Glorious Night, Gilbert had made another talkie that he felt was disastrous. He begged the studio to shelve it. Now they released it. It flopped and damaged Gilbert still further. His co-star was Eleanor Boardman.
We've been talking too loud.
I just remember him as an hysterical person. If he had good reviews, he hit the ceiling. He was the happiest man in the world, and the world, he had it by the tail. But if he had a bad review, he'd go in the dumps, and you couldn't get him out of it.
MGM was now saddled with $1 million a year star who couldn't draw anyone into a theater. That is one of the reasons why people think Mayer may have attempted to sabotage Gilbert's career.
The Fox deal collapsed, but nothing could persuade John Gilbert to break his contract. He drank steadily and sat it out.
And here's to the funeral knell of the living dead.
Mr. Mayer tried as hard as anybody could, and in fact, he came to me and said, Jack seems to regard you as highly as anybody. Will you see if you can keep him in line? And let's get him making movies again, and let's have things working. And I tried for quite a long time. Oh, no, why would they want to destroy one of the great stars?
But had they determined to make a campaign to support Gilbert and to continue this
big investment instead of having the row with them. Their power was so great that I have personally no doubt that whatever little problem might have existed could have been overcome and they could have sustained it and carried on, but they just didn't want to, and the bosses decided they were going to give him the chop, and so they just let him go.
One of Gilbert's problems was that when he finished the picture and they didn't have new pictures to do, he didn't have a character to do, and he had to live with himself. And that's one of the big problems, why he died so young, living with himself. He took to probably drinking too much, took to injections and drugs and so forth, because he didn't have a character to play.
In 1933, Garbo was the greatest star in Hollywood. John Gilbert was all but forgotten. Garbo was powerful enough to force MGM to bring him back. Gilbert had stopped drinking. In the hands of a great director, Reuben Mamoulian, he came to life again.
They warmed and ripened in the Spanish sun. My hacienda is overrun with them.
Audiences could now hear there was nothing wrong with Gilbert's voice.
In the season of the grape harvest, the air smells purple. Purple grapes.
Garbo paid a kind of tribute to the love she had once had for Gilbert. And in this scene, she recalled the power and emotion of the silent films they had made together.
Anyone in this wilderness would have been miracle enough. But to have found you, this is too improbable. I don't believe in you. You're an illusion. You'll vanish before my eyes.
Queen Christina did not make Gilbert popular again. It was more than he could bear. Marlene Dietrich had this color test made in 1934 so he could star opposite her. He had a mild heart attack and was replaced.
I think Gilbert was his own most destructive enemy. He took to drinking very heavily, this is no secret, and he sort of willed himself to die virtually in a beautiful, beautiful place up in the hills, in Beverly Hills, surrounded by some rather attractive women and a lot of empty bottles.
He was 36 years old.
And he was always an enigma. I never solved him. I wished I had. Many people, I guess, have been likened to Mercury, but Jack Gilbert was Mercury. You touch him and he vanished.